Welcome, Trinity Online. My name is Scott, and it is a very special weekend. Today, we are celebrating more than 15 people who are going public with their faith through baptism. Last weekend, we highlighted six of their stories. And if you missed it, I'd highly encourage you to go back and listen into the testimonies of how God's been working in such a unique way through their lives in our faith community during the season. It truly was amazing to hear. Now, our service today is just a wee bit different. For the first time in a long time, we are not live. If you're watching this at 10 on Sunday, this online experience has been pre-recorded because here in Kelowna, we've moved our location just for today from the corner of Springfield and Spall and traveled across the massive bridge to the shores of Green Bay Bible Camp for a good old-fashioned church picnic and baptism. Our experience here online is going to highlight some of our most recent baptism moments from the past, and then I'll be back in a few minutes with a thought on how we celebrate the milestones in our lives, and then challenge you to pray into how God is moving in our church right here and right now. Our experience will be a wee bit shorter today, but wow, it is packed with incredible stories and songs. So take a moment, get comfortable, and get ready. Our special Trinity Online baptism experience begins right now.
God, I'm on my knees again. God, I'm begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh God, I need you.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Oh, on my skin.
Dead men walking, slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you.
Take me to the riverside, take me under, baptize, I need you, oh God, I need you,
oh Lord.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like holy.
Your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
I don't want to abuse your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace, God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Oh, I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness.
Let's Well, in Jamaica, we all grow up having a knowledge of God because our parents, even though some of them may not go to church, they send us to church, right? So we grew up in that atmosphere, knowing God from a very early age. I was baptized as a baby, right? I grew up in the Anglican church. So there is this way they baptize us as a baby, and then we grew up. I was around maybe 13 or 14, grade 9, somewhere there, when I got confirmed. That's, you know, confessing that Jesus is your Lord and Savior. But I was a kid, so for me, it's something that I want to experience as an adult. Growing up, like, I always had this tendency to be a perfectionist, right? Like, everything that I do had to be perfect. And I now understand that coming to God, you don't need to be perfect. He is the one who makes you perfect. You know, He loves when you're broken. He loves when you're contrite. That's how I see myself right now, not trying to attain perfection through my own thought processes, but allowing Him to transform me as I go each and every day.
Now, you grew up in Jamaica.
Grew up in Jamaica.
Okay, and now you're living in Canada, you've got a family.
Like, everything that I knew was reset, right? We got a kid now, like, she's now 5 years old, and that's another story. Like, her coming into this world was a 50-50 chance. Yeah. It was 50-50. I broke down one day when, you know, I couldn't take it anymore. Like, I needed God to tell me she was okay. I didn't understand it, but I knew I had to trust God in the process. And a few months later, she popped up, little Peanut. So we call her Peanut, right? So ever since she was born, her name is Peanut. And I'm just grateful to God that He allowed her to come into this world. God is worthy. You know, it doesn't matter what you're going through. God is always good, and He's worthy. I always felt like there was just one thing missing. My whole life growing up, this one thing is just missing. You know, the Bible says, like, Jesus as an adult, He got baptized, like, He was immersed. So I think the Spirit is just leading me to do likewise, to be obedient, you know. And I think, like, now is the time. It's like COVID and everything, and I've had time to, like, spend time with God, talk to Him, have Him just bring some clarity to my life. And I think now is that time when it should happen. I'd like to thank my mom and my dad. They've been instrumental, sending me to church from a very young age, you know, getting me to have that basic foundation of who God is. I want to thank my wife, who has always been by my side. She's my strength, you know. In those hard times, she's like that strength that I hold on to, my support, and she's an awesome partner. I thank my daughter, for sure, for showing me the little things in life. Sometimes I just need to step away and just let God move. You know, sometimes we're too busy with life, and there's just so simple little things that God wants to show us through our kids. And I'd like to thank my friend Barry, a pastor and a recording artist. He's from Jamaica as well, and he's been a big brother to me. He's been there in the hard times and the good times, and I'll never replace him. Thanks, my friend. Here I am, making my declaration that I am a believer and I want to be baptized. I want to be immersed. So here I am.
Mighty God, we pray your anointing over this strong man. We pray for your favor over him, Jesus. We pray that he will stand up loud like a Daniel, like a Samson, like an Elijah, like a Nehemiah, Heavenly Father. That he proclaim your word without fear or favor, God. And that your hand will be upon his life. So we put him under the blood in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
I will always remember competing in the Canadian Stage Band National Finals at the World's Fair hosted in Vancouver called Expo 86. Yes, I realize like half of you are, I wasn't even born yet, Lanigan, but okay, I digress. It was my first big trip without the parental units, traveling on a coach from Calgary to Vancouver, staying in a hotel. The whole experience was literally eye-popping. And then we did what we really came to do, throw down some jazz, winning the national title. It was actually celebrated by this plaque that I received, which says the Gold Award, Scott Lanigan, fourth lead trumpet, Bishop Pinkham Junior High School in Calgary. Looking at it, actually, all these memories come flooding back, like forgetting my wallet at the top of the Harbor Center Tower, only to come back and find it 6 hours later. And the memory of actually playing in the competition. It's what plaques are made for, right? Memorializing a poignant moment or memory in your life. This plaque actually reminds me of one of those moments in Scripture. It's probably one of the most climactic events in the Bible. Hundreds of thousands of Israelites standing on the edge of the Jordan River, and a possible obstacle between them and God's promise of a land to call their own. Their desperation to cross must have been tactile. 4 decades of meandering around in a barren wilderness, bare survival of living a nomadic life, tragic memories of an entire generation of people lost, families and friends who did not trust God's promises enough to make it to this very moment, years of brute force slavery in Egypt. As they're standing there, it was flood season. The river was a force to behold. Absolutely menacing in its speed, expansive in its reach, and perilous for what it concealed. The sounds of uncontrolled rushing water overwhelmed any faint hope they had left. And then it happened. The God of the impossible showed up, miraculously rolling back the torrential waters of the Jordan River, a wall of water on one side, a dry riverbed on the other. It was monumental. Joshua 4 captures the next moments. It says this, when the whole nation had finished crossing the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, choose 12 men from among the people, one from each tribe, and tell them to take up 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, from right where the priests are standing, and carry them over with you and put them down at the place where you stay tonight. It's exactly what Joshua did. He told 12 men to go hoist heavy stones on their shoulders from the Jordan's floor and then carry them along the path until their resting spot that evening. And because stones don't naturally stack, as we all know, Joshua knew there would come a day when the next generation would ask for an explanation of this phenomenon. These stones stack up. They'd be saying, like, what do these stones mean? And Joshua told them this. Tell them, Israel crossed the Jordan on dry ground, for the Lord your God dried up the Jordan before until you had crossed over. The Lord your God did to the Jordan what he had done to the Red Sea when he dried it up before us until we had crossed over. He did this so that all the peoples of the earth that's you and me, might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful, and so that you might always, that's you and me, fear the Lord your God. This is what happens when the impossible meets the promises of God. Come to think of it, at this point in my life, I'm pretty sure I've forgotten more than I remember. You know what I mean? There's just so many experiences, disappointments, joys, surprises in my life that just gone, faded, disappeared. It's not that I don't want to hold on to them. It's just that I didn't take time to mark it or have a plaque made. This story reminded me of how important that is, especially when it comes to faith. Like what some members of our faith community are doing today, publicly declaring their faith through baptism. It is a tangible, visible form of God's work in their lives, a physical means designed to trigger our spiritual senses. Stacking stones or baptism waters are not for God's memories, they're for ours. We don't remember the past great works of God or the things we're doing today so that we can live in a dreamland or just hold on to that moment thinking that the best days of our Christian experience are behind us. No, rather, we mark the moment as a point of faith so we can trust God for greater things to come. Not to draw attention to what we did, rather to say and declare, this is what God has done. I have seen and experienced his past faithfulness and I'm going to see it again. Establishing physical memories to spiritual milestones reinforces the reality of God's power in our lives and causes us to do one thing, worship him, remember him, celebrate him. I have one of those spiritual memories. It's actually this, a Gideon Bible. Years ago, a group of individuals would go to schools and tell kids of God's faithfulness through passing them out a free little New Testament with the Psalm and Proverbs. This one is the one my papa gave to me. My papa Sawyer lived in one of the Gulf Islands and I would travel there for summers and often I would go with him as he distributed some of these little Gideon Bibles. And then one day he gave me this one. And I hold on to it because it reminds me. It reminds me of my papa's faithfulness, his simplicity, and his unending trust in God. And it reminds me of who God is, what God has done, the things that I have built my life on. So I wonder, like this Gideon New Testament that has infused the faith of my grandfather into my life and reminded me of God's faithfulness in his, what spiritual stones do you need to set up today? The story of your life that God is the author of, reminders that protect your heart, that guide your steps and infuse your faith from what God has done in the past to what he might do in the future. Spiritually significant moments that pass your legacy of faith to the next generation. Don't waste your life today. Don't sit in front of the TV or get lost in the circumstances of your life today. Rather, allow those moments that God showed up in your life and his presence that was with you always and will always be, and declare the faith of what he's done for you and what he can do for others. Are you using the pictures on your walls or the images on your phone to tell the greatness of God? I love how Psalm 103 puts it. Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. Would you pray with me? God, you've done so much in our lives. You've been consistent. Your promises have never failed. Your faithfulness has lasted from generation to generation. We sing that you're the same God, and God, we declare that today. We trust that today. May we have the courage to set those spiritual reminders, those spiritual stones in our lives as a moment, as a starting point to give us hope for the future, faith for the future, courage for the future, to trust you more than we ever have. And God, may this generation and the next generation look back at our lives and go, wow, if God was faithful there, he can be faithful to me too. Thank you that you are who you say you are and that you love us beyond what we absolutely deserve. God, we love you today and we're grateful for this moment and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, when we were little, my mom took us to a Pentecostal church, so we got pretty excited about God and Jesus at that time. And as I grew up, it kind of faded away on my mom's side a little bit. And my friend, I had a good friend who was a Christian, and so we went to youth group. And I had a lot of questions. I was a bit of a questioner, a bit of a picking the verses apart thing. So I'm not 100% sure I was... I was still thinking a bit critically about Jesus, and so it's taken me a long time to just sort of feel him and understand more what he's about. So, but I think those early stages of questioning were really critical for me to start answering some questions. You know, there was a question about how are you pursuing God? But I think for my life, God has been pursuing me. And so he always, as I would fall away in my 20s and things, there would magically be an old grandpa figure with the very same rare breed of dog as myself that would show up at my doorstep and befriend me and just happen to be a Christian who brought us back into the church, right? And, when we moved away, we lost that. And then when we came back, we knew there was something missing in our lives still, and so we needed to pursue that. So we came back to Trinity, and we built our faith a bit again, right, and immersed ourselves in. And so we've been impressed upon our hearts, my wife and I, that we would like to adopt and have a child, an international child, come into our home and be part of our family and fill a need there. And so we found our forever son in Ethiopia, and we had to go there, but you could go there and then come home, but we couldn't bring ourselves to do that. We wanted to be a family there, so we stayed, but the process was very long. The documents have to get sent out of country, and in Kenya there was a coup going on, so the embassy that was doing it had sent everybody home, so there was nobody there, and so we had no idea what was going to happen. And to make a long story short, there was a whole series of phone calls and events, and we got a call at 12 o'clock on the day that we were going home, when we were leaving 6 hours later, that we could actually all go home as a family. And I was at the adoption place just about to ask the lady who could translate for our son to say, "You can't come home with us today. And Dad's gonna have to stay, and everyone else is leaving." And after like 30 days to Canada, counting down, and we got a phone call the second I was about to say that, and it was amazing, right? We all rejoiced. It was like, wow, this is incredible. This really happened. So those recent events really started to show me more who he was and how he shows up. I want to be baptized because I've really come to the realization over the last 6 to 8 months, I finally feel I'm at a place where I can immerse myself completely in Jesus. I would really like to thank my wife for being on this journey with me, and my children for always keeping me faithful and keeping me accountable. I want to always also thank my mother, who's always been steadfast but gentle and gently pushing me always in the right direction, but never forcefully and always supportively. And I would like to thank my two men's groups, GWG, that really got me into becoming a part of a men's group, and my current group that's with the Trinity Church Anywhere. You know who you guys are, so thank you all so much. I'm here today to tell you that Jesus Christ will forever be my Lord and Savior.
I grew up in an Anglican home. I went to church on the weekends with my mom as a child. But as an early teen, I fell away. I got involved in, I had a job, I liked skiing, and so that's kind of where my weekends took me. And I didn't really have that influence to say, come on, let's stay on track. In my 20s, when I met my husband, we kind of, he was Pentecostal, I was Anglican, and those are two very different religions. So we kind of worked to try and find a middle ground. We went, dabbled in and out of a few churches, kind of helped support a few youth groups along the way. But I would say I was really focused on my career. I built my career in my 20s and 30s. And that was my focus. God wasn't a part of that journey with me. Then I gave birth to two children and life changed. After my daughter, I had significant postpartum depression. It was a hard time. And for years, I felt like I kind of had this black hole in here. And then one day we moved back to Kelowna and I'd given birth to my son. And somebody had said, hey, actually, they said, you got to try out this church at the corner of Springfield and Spall. It's named Trinity. And we just moved back and we said, okay. And we came here and I was like, I really want to raise my children in a Christian home. I want to have that Sundays together. Like we'll have Sunday, we'll have Sunday dinner. That was the limit of my knowledge of church. And so we started coming here and my husband loved the cinnamon buns and I loved sitting without children wiggling on my lap. And so Trinity was great. And then we just kept going and we kept coming. And I feel like God has put this scaffolding in my life on my faith. The event that happened for me was there was a service that we had, and I can distinctly remember it. It was on Isaiah 1:18, and it was, I, the Lord, invite you to come and talk it over. Your sins are scarlet red, but they will be whiter than snow. And I remember that service where, at places where I just felt like I couldn't even forgive myself. I was like, oh, I don't have to because God forgives me and that Jesus died for my sins. And that significantly impacted my life from that moment forward. I started joining She Cafe. The kids came, they went to, you know, the weekend services with us. We started to volunteer. I started leading a She Cafe group. We started volunteering with youth. We've done various things throughout the church. We help in the kitchen. We've helped with summer camps. We help at the Christmas service. We've been helping at Helen's Acres. And so Trinity has become just part of our family. It's part of our community. It's part of who we are. I would like to thank Twyla for all those years ago discussing with me about becoming a leader at She Cafe. I would like to thank Yvette and Bev for showing me what it is to be a woman of faith. I would like to thank Andrew, a teenage boy who lived with us, who taught me how to pray out loud with somebody else. I would like to thank Kayan, who taught me to pray incessantly. I would like to thank my children for showing me what it is, the importance of having a church community. And I would like to thank my husband for walking alongside me every step of the way. I want to declare Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I want to follow him for the rest of my life. Well, I always grew up, my mom and dad raised me Christian, and my understanding was God was our savior, but the reassurance of God and eternal life always has helped me. Whenever I go to camp, sometimes I feel down and I don't want to go because I always like want to be with my parents, but whenever I leave it, I feel refilled, and like I always enjoy learning about God, and the way they do it just makes me feel so happy. And it feels like a safe space, and all of the cabin leaders are like really nice people. And like whenever I have a question about God or something he did, they always answered it for me, which was really nice. And it makes me so overwhelmed of what God can do for us. I connect best with God when I'm in the wilderness. When I hear the trees rustling and the wind river flowing, I like the silence of it. And I feel like God speaks to me through that. Before, I always thought that we were the people who were making the effort, like the main effort to follow God. But God's actually the one who's making the effort to pursue us. And no matter how far we run away from him, he'll always be with us. I'd like to thank my parents for bringing me up in a Christian home and for what they've done for me. I would also especially like to thank my cabin leaders and answering all the questions. And last person I'd like to thank would be my Bible teacher at school. He makes us take notes in class on Bible, and I feel like he talks about some of the books in Bible and we have to read it with him, but when I take notes, it helps me remember it best. So I have some of the Bible classes ingrained in my mind, which is really nice. I'm here to declare Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Story that is in this room. People following you to the extent that they just want to say, I'm going to go public with my faith. As they are celebrated today for doing that, God, I just pray a favor and a blessing on their lives. Because wherever there is positive step forward in our spiritual life, we also recognize that there is a opposing force that wants to take us down. And so we pray right now that we are gonna recognize that and go, not me, not on my turf. I am a child of the Most High God. And so Father, thank you that we have that victory. Thank you that we can do this together. Thank you for the celebration that we have today of these stories. You are so good to us. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right, let's get some people dumped.
Remember? I told you it was going to be a great experience today. It is so evident that God is on the move in our community, and so excited to celebrate the transformative work that he's doing in these days and beyond. Through us, through you, and Trinity Online, you're a part of that story too. So make sure you're here next weekend as we kick off our summer series called United. It seems that everywhere you look these days, people are at odds and divided more than ever. Whether it's political opinions, conspiracy theories, or the increased global tensions we've all been experiencing these past few years, it's safe to say that we're living in a very fractured world. And unfortunately, this reality has not escaped the church community as well. So for the next 12 weeks, we'll be taking a deep dive into the book of Ephesians chapter 4 and teaching verse through verse through what scripture has to say about living lives in community that pursues unity in our actions, our speech, and most of all, how we follow Jesus. We've been praying into this series for months now, and we know God is going to do something new in us through it. We're believing for it, so don't miss out. Be here every weekend through the summer. And hey, thanks for joining us today. We will see you next week for our kickoff weekend of United.